Thank you very much. I am delighted to be here, and I appreciate the invitation. I have no potential conflict of interest, and the content of this talk will is displayed in this slide. I will first make an introduction on human brain development and thyroid hormone deficiency. Then I will explain the work we have been doing, and we are proceeding in our laboratory on brain histopathology and MCTN mutations. And then I will explain the interrelations between thyroid hormone transport, metabolism, and action in the brain. And finally, I will speak about the genes regulated by T3 neural cells. So this slide overlaps what John Lazarus said before, and this scheme of brain development, human brain development, and in relation with thyroid hormone secretion and the birth, to show that the main events in brain development occur after thyroid hormone secretion from the fetus is already established. So before, during early development, the process of neurogenesis is probably not under strict thyroid hormone control. But then there is a period of neuronal migration, and then cortical maturation, myelination, synapse formation, synaptogenesis, and axon and dendrite sprouting that are depending on thyroid hormones. Here is the relation between these processes with the secretion of thyroid hormone from the fetus and the presence of thyroid hormone receptor. Thyroid hormone receptors are present in the brain, as we demonstrated already many years ago in the human brain, the receptor protein, not the mRNA. The receptor protein before week 10 of development is very low and increases very fast between week 10 to week 20. So this is a period of very critical development in the human brain as and is probably under control by the maternal thyroid hormone. The deficiency of thyroid hormone during fetal development, as you know, may lead to several syndromes. And classically, we distinguish between neurological cretinism or myxedematous cretinism. And the main difference between these two forms of cretinism is the timing of the brain lesion that occurs in neurological cretinism around the second trimester of pregnancy, and in myxedematous cretinism probably after birth, during the neonatal life. And this is similar also to what happens to congenital hypothyroidism. And the reason why in myxedematous cretinism or in congenital hypothyroidism compared with neurological cretinism, there is no strong neurological impairment is probably because maternal thyroid hormone protects the brain from neural lesions. And the main defect that are observed then after birth in myxedematous cretinism or in congenital hypothyroidism refer to general hypothyroidism. Now, recently, there is another syndrome that is thought to be due to deficient thyroid hormone action in the brain during development is MCTA mutations. As you will see in the next few slides, probably the brain lesion in MCTA mutations occur also during the prenatal life. We know that at around week 30, lesions are already can be demonstrated in the brain of MCTA patients, but we don't know whether there are lesions that are established before week 30. And we know very little on the histopathological consequences of the brain structure in neurological cretinism or in myxedematous cretinism or congenital hypothyroidism for many obvious reasons. And, but we have the opportunity to examine the brain of patients with MCTA mutations, and this has two double interest. One, because if we assume that MCTN mutations are due to lack of thyroid hormone in the brain, then we may have a glimpse of what deficiency of thyroid hormone in the human brain, how it alters the structure of the brain. And this is the comparison between MCT8 mutations and congenital or endemic cretinism. As said before, the Alan Herndon-Dudley syndrome, which is due to mutation in the thyroid hormone receptor, the thyroid hormone transporter, although it was described in 1944, it was not until 2004 that Refetov and Visser described mutations in the gene encoding the transporter MCT8. Now, this is probably the most serious condition related to thyroid hormone deficiency during development, and it appears early after birth, during the first few months of life, and is dominated by strong hypotonia, and then evolving to spastic quadriplegia and global developmental delay. The children have absolutely lack of speech, very low IQ, and interestingly, there are alterations of thyroid hormone metabolism leading to very high T3 concentrations in the blood, low T4, and low RT3. The low T4 in these babies may orient or may confuse with the may have some confusion with the congenital hypothyroidism, and some patients may be treated as congenital hypothyroid, which is not advisable because then T3 becomes very, very, very extremely high in their blood. As I said before, we had the opportunity to study how the brain of these patients are altered. And here I will show you two or three slides on the main features that we found. And these studies have been done in the lab by Ana Guadaño Ferraz and Daniela López Espíndola. And they have been published, there is paper in last December in Journal Clinical Endocrinology and Metabolism. Now we analyzed a 30-week fetus and an 11-year-old child, and here there is evidence, we show evidence of alteration of neuronal differentiation, looking at expression of a neurofilament, and you can see here the cortex in the control versus the MCT8, and here you can see that there is expression of the neurofilament, no expression in the MCT8. Interestingly, I will then repeat several times these cells, the Cajal residue cells, which are a minority of neurons that are present early during development in the fetus, but not probably in the adult. And they are present in the control cerebral cortex, but not in the MCT8 deficient fetus. And these cells are involved in the migration of cells from the ventricular layer to form the layers of the mature cortex. So deficiency of these cells lead to altered cerebral cortex structure with not well-defined cortex layer. This is something that we also see in hypothyroid rats or mice. Now, for example, in the cerebellum, there is also altered neurofilament expression in the pons. And here you can see that the caliber, the axons are very low caliber. This is also axons, cross-section of the axons, staying with neurofilament. You can see in the normal brain, there are the diameter is thick, whereas in the MCTA deficient fetus is narrow. This is myelination. Myelination is under control of thyroid hormone, and this is expression of myelin basic protein. You can see strong differences in the cerebellum and in other parts of the brain. And here in the child, also there is also deficient myelination. Then cymatogenesis, developmental pattern that is under thyroid hormone control. Here we look at the expression of synaptophysin, which is the major protein of the synaptic vesicles. This is in the cerebellum, the Purkinje cell, in the control, the synaptophysin is expressed in a punctate pattern showing the synaptic vesicles, but here hardly we can see any synaptophysin in the child, in the MCTA in an 11-year-old child. So in the MCTA defect, we see features of brain damage that resemble, in many respects, the alterations that we see in rodents as a consequence of thyroid hormone deficiency. For example, a very altered differentiation of Cajal residue cells, lack of parvalbumin interneurons that I haven't shown, but we also find that, deficient axonal and dendritic maturation, deficient synaptogenesis, deficient myelination, and also altered expression of genes that are under control of thyroid hormones, such as neurofilaments, myelin, parvalbumin, calbindin, synaptophysin, and others. All this is compatible with effective action of thyroid hormones, indicating that the lesion that MCT8 mutation lives in the brain is due to absent thyroid hormone action and not to another unrelated function of the MCT8 transporter. Also, the study of the MCT8 transporter, the MCT8 deficient mice especially, also have helped us to prove the model that we established many years ago based on the expression of the iodinase 2 and 3 in the brain. We proposed that circulating T4 and T3 can enter the brain, and T3 may enter directly through the blood-brain barrier and be available to the neurons or to the astrocytes, and also another way of intra-brain T3 formation would be the iodination of T4 taking place in the astrocytes. Now the T3 form would cross the membrane of the astrocyte and neurons and act on the nuclei. And then in the neurons, the iodinase 3 would degrade T4 and T3 to the inactive metabolites RT3 and T2. And we now know that in this process is essential the presence of transporters. And probably MCT8, MCT8, the main function of MCT8 is the blood-brain barrier. And there is another transporter in mice and rats, OTP1C1, that also John Lazarus alluded to, that is a specific T4 transport and allows the passage to the astrocyte to form the T3. And now the transfer from T3, from the astrocyte to the neurons, is not very clear. And we know that all these transporters are present both in the astrocytes and neuron, and maybe a combination of these transporters would allow the passage of T3 to the neurons. But we know that in MCTA deficiency, there is no restriction for the passage of T3 from the astrocytes to the neurons. There is a restriction in the blood-brain barrier, but not in the passage from the astrocyte form. Now, why in mice, OATP1C1 acts as a compensation for the defect in MCT8. And this doesn't happen in the MCT8 deficient patient, because in human, there is very low expression of OATP1C1 in the human BBB. Therefore, the human needs MCT8 also for the transfer of T4 to the astrocyte. And this is the mutation in this transporter makes that both T4 and T3 becomes restrictive for the passage to the in the blood-brain barrier. Now, finally, we have also gene expression. After T4 and T3 are in the astrocyte neurons, I didn't represent here other cells that are important, for example, the tanycytes for formation of T3 because they express T2, or also the myelin producing cell oligodendrocytes that are in a respect similar to the neurons. And we know that many genes are under thyroid hormone control. For example, here we have some of our favorite genes, neurofilaments, semaphorin, serrated protein, reelin, CAM kinase 4, and others. And there are many, many genes that are regulated by thyroid hormone in development. These are studies performed several years in our laboratory by Pilar Gilibañez and Beatriz Morte, looking by microarray and on how hypothyroidism alters the expression of genes in the mouse brain, looking at the neocortex and the striatum. And you can see here comparing the hypothyroid versus the euthyroid controls. You can see that there are genes that are downregulated, many genes downregulated in the hypothyroidism, and many genes that are upregulated, both in the striatum and the neocortex. But interestingly, from 334 genes that were altered in the neocortex and 1,000 in the striatum, there is only 173 that were common in between the two regions. That makes the analysis extremely difficult because we don't know whether what genes are directly responsible to thyroid hormones or they are altering hypothyroidism as a consequence of organismic hypothyroidism and not representing the real action of thyroid hormone in the brain. So we recently turned to another more simple system, and it's cerebral cortical cells, primary cerebral cortical cells in primary culture. Here, these experiments were done by Pilar Gilibañez and Beatriz Morte, and they start from embryos, mouse embryos of 17.5. They isolated the cerebral cortex and put in the pretty dish. They established the primary cultures. And after a period of thyroid hormone deprivation, they had T3 here and wait for 24 hours. Now, the first experiments were done to see whether the system was working properly, and we didn't show any effect of T3 on cells that were deficient of TR-alpha and TR-beta, demonstrating that TR-alpha and TR-beta transduce the T3 response. And we have here what we call after, in normal cells, by RNA-seq, we detect the differentially expressed genes at 24 hours. But we do another experiment, is to challenge the cell with cyclohexamides to inhibit protein synthesis and look at the effect of T3 in the presence of cyclohexamide at 6 hours. So we, after doing RNA-seq in this culture, we have directly regulated genes. And this is an example. These are two genes, for example, hairless and LDH1A1. This is the responsible for synthesis for retinoic acid. And 24 hours after T3, there is a nice response of T3 in the hairless gene and also in LDH1A1. LDH1A1, by the way, is also regulated by dexamethasone, and both dexamethasone and T3 are synergistic and present very strong induction. Now, 6 hours in the presence of cyclohexamide, hairless is still responsive, demonstrating that it's a direct transcriptional response to T3, whereas LDH1A1 is not responsive, demonstrating that it's a secondary gene after T3. So this is a volcano plot of the differentially expressed gene from the 24 hours after T3. And here is the summary from 15,000 genes, around 15,000 genes that are expressed in the cultures, around 1,000 are regulated by T3. And from this, we have about upregulated 600, about half is upregulated and half are downregulated. But in the presence of cyclohexamide, we have a fraction of the genes that are still responding, and from the upregulated genes, 254, and the downregulated, 116, which is a quite large number. I mean, about one-third of all the genes that are regulated by T3 in the primary cultures, in neurons and astrocytes, because it's a mixed culture, they represent direct transcriptional responses to T3. And here are the gene ontology, what processes are regulated by T3. What are regulated are axon guidance, transmission of the nerve impulse, ion transport, myelin assembly, and downregulated cell division, then the cell cycle, or up or down regulated both neurogenesis and neuron differentiation. This is, for example, one of the processes regulated by thyroid hormone. This is axon guidance, and we found around 30 genes that are involved in this process. The red ones are the directly responsive genes, and the white ones are the indirectly regulated genes. There are here some very interesting genes, like, for example, SONIC. There is a SEMA3A, semaphorin, and its receptor, NRP1, or the EFRINs, which are very interesting targets as regulated by thyroid hormone. And now, another useful thing that is very useful for the primary cells is that they are a mix of cellular types. For example, here, the cells have been stained by for astrocyte with GFAP, for neurons, neuron, and this is the nuclei. And here is the same culture stain for the protein reeling that only stains a very small amount of cells, the Cajal residue cells in the layer one, and orcal binding. There are very few cells that are stained with calbinding. So this means that the culture represents a mix of primary culture. And we have exploited this property of the culture by looking at the identification of T3 regulated genes in very specific cell types. Now, to make this very simple, we isolated the primary culture and did RNA-seq, and so we have the T3 regulated transcriptome, but then we cross our data with cell-specific transcriptome derived from the same cultures by looking at the specific transcriptome of neurons, oligodendrocytes, astrocytes, microglia, endothelial cells, and so on, by using data from other people that they were published. So we have now the list of genes that are regulated by T3 in specific cellular types, for example, neurons or astrocytes in general, and we arrived to the conclusion that about 10% of the genes regulated by thyroid hormone in neurons are directly responsive to T3, and also 5% of the genes directly from astrocytes are directly regulated by T3. Now, for example, in neurons, we have the somatostatin receptor, CAM kinase 4, neurofilament, upregulated, or the glycine receptor, or GABA receptor, downregulated on in astrocyte, aquaporin, which is upregulated, et cetera. Also, it is possible to look at expression of the effect of T3 in specific cells from the cortical layers. And here we analyze the corticotalamic, the layer 6 or layer 5A, CCK neurons, and pineal neurons. So just to demonstrate that T3 alters the expression of, regulates directly the expression of gene expression in this all these cells. So finally, the Cajal residue cells, which are targets of T3, as I said before, here is, for example, this Cajal residue cells in layer one of the cerebral cortex that express the protein reeling, and this is the difference between control and hypothyroid rats, or as I said before, in the human embryos, in between the control and the MCTA deficient patient, there are no Cajal residue cells. And doing the similar approach as explained before, we arrived to genes that are regulated directly by thyroid hormone in the embryonic Cajal residue cells. These are genes regulated at the transcriptional level, the red ones, or in the P2 Cajal residue cells. Now, just to finish, we also analyze what effect of thyroid hormone has during development from the transition from the fetal cortex to adult cortex. And it has been demonstrated that in this transition, there are genes that are downregulated and genes that are upregulated. Now, looking at the transcriptome that thyroid hormone affect these genes, how they are regulated and downregulated in the primary culture, we found that from the fetal enriched genes present in the culture, T3 downregulates most of them here, and upregulates only a few of them. And from the adult enriched genes present, T3 upregulates most of them, but downregulates some of them. But mostly upregulation of the adult enriched genes and downregulation of the fetal enriching. What does this mean? This means that thyroid hormone facilitates the transition from the fetal to adult patterns of gene expression. And by doing a gene ontology analysis of these genes, we found that the downregulated genes are mainly concerned with cell division, cell cycle, chromosome condensation, and so on, that are downregulated by T3, and the upregulated are concerned with neurotransmission, synaptic transmission, chemical homeostasis, and ion transport. Now, this conclusion would not be so surprising, but at last we have the molecular basis to ensure that that thyroid hormone facilitates the fetal to adult patterns of gene expression during development. So as conclusions, brain damage in MCT8 mutation start at or before the 30th week of gestation. Brain damage in MCT8 is compatible with deficient T3 action in the brain due to a transport defect through the BBB. T3 regulates the expression of many genes directly at the transcriptional level, around 30% of all regulated genes. T3 exerts direct transcriptional control in practically all neural cells, and T3 facilitates the transition from a fetal to an adult pattern of gene expression. And finally, a list of my collaborators in our institute. We also collaborated with a center in Valencia for the RNA-seq analysis. And we collaborate with Sandra Fetov at the University of Chicago and also several departments of medicine and pathology in Madrid, Australia, and Israel in the analysis of the human brain. And thank you very much.